In this experiment, we will build a model of a motor. For this, we will need a pair of scissors, copper wire, 26 standard wire gauge or higher, ring magnets or neodymium magnets, a cycle tube, a 1.5 volt battery, and two large safety pins. Wind the copper wire about 7 to 10 times around your fingers to form a loop of diameter of about 1 centimeter. Stretch the two ends of the wire diametrically opposite to each other. Knot the ends of the wire around the coil so that they don't come undone. With the help of the scissors, scrape the insulation from all sides on one end of the wire. On the other end, scrape off the insulation on three sides, leaving the insulation intact on one side of the wire. Keep this setup aside. Cut the cycle tube into bands. Stretch the bands around the battery as shown. Use the cycle tube band to firmly attach the magnet to the battery. Attach the two safety pins to the battery terminals using the other cycle tube band. Ensure the loops of the safety pin are on the top. The setup should look something like this. Take the copper wire loop and insert the two ends of the wire into the safety pin loops. Make sure the copper wire loop is right above the magnet but does not touch it. Adjust the height of the safety pins if required. You will see, once the loop is placed over the magnets, it starts rotating. If the loop is not rotating on its own, nudge it lightly. In this setup, we have built a simplified model of how a motor works. The function of a motor is to convert an electrical input into mechanical output. To create a mechanical output, the motor needs to generate a mechanical or moving force. When a current-carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, it experiences a force. In a motor, we use this principle to create a moving force or output. To get maximum moving force from a motor, the current-carrying conductor is set up in the shape of a rectangle. When the conductor is connected as shown in diagram 1, the current flows from the positive terminal to point A, A to B, B to C, C to D, and then from point D to the negative terminal. When this current-carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, a force acts on it. The direction of this force can be determined using Fleming's left-hand rule, which states, when the thumb, index and middle fingers of the left hand are stretched mutually perpendicular to each other, and if the index finger is in the direction of the magnetic field and the middle finger is in the direction of the current, then the thumb will point in the direction of the force acting on the conductor. The direction of current in one side, AB, is opposite to the direction of current in the opposite side, CD, of the conductor. Hence, the force experienced by the opposite sides of the conductor are also opposite in nature. As shown in diagram 2, one side of the conductor, AB, is pushed down and the other side of the conductor, CD, is pushed up. This way, a rotating force or a torque acts on the conductor, making it rotate. As shown in diagram 3, When the plane of the conductor is at 90 degrees to the magnetic field, the force experienced by the two sides of the conductor are equal and opposite. Hence, there is no effective force acting on the conductor. The inertia of the moving conductor helps it to move to the position shown in diagram 4. From the position shown in diagram 4, to complete one full rotation, side CD has to be pushed down and side AB has to be pushed up. For side CD to experience a downward force and side AB to experience an upward force, current in the conductor has to flow from point D to C to B to A. In other words, the direction of the current has to be reversed. To reverse the direction of current, a device called commutator is used. A commutator consists of two semicircular copper pieces and two carbon brushes. The copper pieces are attached to the conductor. The carbon brushes are connected to the positive and negative terminals of the battery. When the semicircular copper pieces touch the carbon brush, the circuit is closed and current flows through the conductor. In diagram 2, the green copper piece is on the left and current flows from A to B to C to D. This causes the side AB to move down and side CD to move up. After completing half rotation, the yellow copper piece is on the left and the current now flows from D to C to B to A. This causes the side CD to move down and side AB to move up. This way, the conductor completes one full rotation. This rotating conductor can be connected to rotate the blades of a fan or any appliances with moving parts. In this setup, the coil of wire is the current carrying conductor and the magnetic field of the permanent magnet is acting on the coil. This makes it a current carrying conductor in a magnetic field. The force experienced by the coil pushes one side of the coil down and the other side up, making it spin. The part of the wire where the insulation was not scraped off acts as the commutator. When this part is in touch with the safety pin, it cuts the circuit and stops the current supply to the coil. When the coil rotates further due to its inertia, the non-insulated parts of the wire come in contact with the safety pin. When this happens, the circuit is again closed, but the direction of the current in the coil is now reversed. This makes the coil spin forward instead of spinning back and forth.